I have hundreds and hundreds of races stored in my heart, and many of them come with stories. And what I've done is I've actually written a couple down, because if I don't write them down, then I'll just ramble on and tell you snippets of too many stories instead of one or two that helped shape, you know, who I am and why, how I now coach success in all the individual kids, teenagers, young women, and age groupers that I'm coaching now. So my first story starts in 1996, and I entered my first big pro race as a duathlete. Duathlon was a really big sport from the 70s right up until triathlon made its debut in the Olympics in 2000. And duathlon was a really good sport for me because I got to run twice. I ran at the beginning, then you got to bike, and then you got to run again. And often, there was a longer run at the end. So for somebody who really liked to be tough, trying to run 12K off the bike at the end of a two-hour race was really just right up my alley. So this was a big race for me. It was a Powerman duathlon. And Powermans were known for being hilly and tough and long. And this one was in Chicago. So I actually had to make a pretty big commitment in travel and accommodation just to even get to Chicago. And I was hoping to win a lot of that back in prize money by doing well at the race. So the morning of the race, I left this little seedy motel that I was staying in Chicago for as low money a night that I could find. And actually, I was sharing it with my now husband, Lance, and two other athletes. So we were splitting this little seedy motel room. And I left with my bike and all my gear, and I went riding down the bike path by the lake to get to the transition area. It was a bit safer to actually ride down the bike path to get to the race start than to ride down the freeway of Chicago, which was already busy and not yet closed for the race. And there I was riding down the bike path, and I felt my tire go flat. I felt my front wheel go flat. Now, I just wasn't riding any old front wheel. I had a front wheel with a tubular tire on it, and tubular tires are glued on. They're glued on. You can get them off, but they're really hard to get off, and you really don't want to be changing your glued-on tire right before a race. So there I was. I had half an hour to the race start, or 45 minutes to the race start, and my tire had gone flat, and I thought, well, how? And I'm on a bike path. I'm not even on the road, so I can get a ride. And luckily, I kind of looked up, and there was a building there, like some kind of civic building, turned out to be a museum, and it was open, and somebody called a cab. And some Chicago cabbie came roaring up to the museum to pick me up and my bike. We shoved my bike in this guy's trunk, and he buzzed me over to the transition area. And I got out of the cab, got all my stuff out of his trunk, and my bags, my transition bag, went to get my wallet, and my wallet's gone. But I know I had my wallet because I had left the hotel with my wallet, and I know I wouldn't leave my wallet in the motel. So I'm like, oh my gosh, it must have fallen out back when I was taking my wheel off and getting all my bags into this guy's trunk. So I got back in the cab and he drove me back to the museum. And there on the street was my wallet, just right where I packed my bike, open, intact. I was already feeling lucky because this is Chicago. So I got my wallet, put everything back in the car, in the cab. The cab got me to the transition zone. And, oh, you know, the other thing I felt so lucky was that I had all my traveler's checks in my wallet, because back in 1996, I didn't have a visa. When you went traveling, you took traveler's checks, and traveler's checks are cash. That was all Lance's and my trip money for the whole time. So here I'd found everything again. I was pretty happy. I paid the cab driver his triple fee for driving me back and forth. But, you know, it was funny because he was so into it. You know, he was like, okay, get you back here. You got a race. So he was totally into it. But when I got to the transition, I still had a flat tire, the tubular that was glued to my front wheel, and I had about 15 minutes now to my race start. And I really, really wanted to start that race. This was my first big race. There were, like, lots of big names there. I was really excited to start. Well, Lance was there, and he said, Lucy, give me your stuff. You go warm up. I'll come up with a solution. Your bike will be in transition when you finish the first run. And I said, okay. I really had no choice. I just had to give my bike to Lance and go warm up and get myself to the start line. We didn't even have a plan for how I was going to find my bike in transition. There's this huge, long transition area with hundreds of bikes. And so I went to warm up. I had 10 minutes at this point. I went to warm up. a little warm up before the race. Right before the race start, Lance came over to me and said, "Hey, your bike's going to be here." And he basically gave me a big like signpost to look for when I was going to come into back into transition. And anyway, I started the race. I just started it on pure blind faith. And I don't actually remember much about the race at all. I don't remember much about the first run. I do remember the bike. The bike was really, really hard and really, really windy. And I kept on looking at this front wheel, which wasn't mine, wondering where this front wheel came from. Because it wasn't my front wheel. And I was still very much a runner at this stage of my career, and so the bike was really hard. I was a good cyclist, but I wasn't as good as some of the other women who had been doing it for 5 or 10 years, and I got passed by a lot of women on the bike. And I came in, and to do the second run, and the second run was 12K, which was just great for me. That means that gave me over 45 minutes to try to make up as much time as possible on all the women who had passed me already on the bike, because that typically was what happened early on in my career. I would get out first in the run, come back first or second to transition, get passed a few times, and then try to get them all back again on the second run. It was a big game. It was actually quite a lot of fun. Anyway, and so I learned that Lance had asked an age grouper if we could borrow her front wheel after she had finished racing. So Lance had just found some random stranger who looked friendly, and she finished racing and had somehow managed, while I was on the first run, to give her front wheel to Lance. Lance had changed my wheel, put my bike in transition so that my bike was there for me when I came back in after the first run. And you know, I remember this as kind of a defining moment of my career, this whole race. I didn't really know it at the time. I wasn't probably old enough and experienced enough, but it was a defining moment of my career, because in all these little crazy chain of events that was leading up to me getting to that start line, I never lost my head. I got a little anxious, especially when I found my wallet was gone with all my traveler's checks in it. But somehow I managed to not lose my head and to just get from one of these little problems to the next, because all I really wanted to do was to get to the start line. It was such a strong goal for me that I really just accepted the situation, tried to work with it and get to the start line. And you know, I only really remember that I came third because Lance remembers all these things, because he's such a great coach. He always remembers statistics and figures like great coaches do. And also because I have it written down. I have it written down in one of my lists of accomplishments that I had to write down, because that's what pro athletes do. We write all our accomplishments down, because those quantifiable figures are kind of what the media always wants to see. But for me, you know, the success of what I remember is the success of actually problem solving that day and redirecting my energy, and just the sheer willingness of wanting to make it happen and of Lance wanting to make it happen. And just because, you know, really, I wanted to race that race so bad. And you know, it's funny, because that crazy chain of events happened to me. A few years later, I got to run. I got to do a triathlon in Minneapolis. It was called the Lifetime Fitness Triathlon, and it was the biggest prize money race in the world at the time. In fact, I think it still is. There's a couple in the States that put out enormous prize money to draw as many of the top pros as they can. And I was kind of lucky. I got to go to the very first one. And it was called the Lifetime Fitness Triathlon. And it was a crazy, crazy race where they started the women ahead of the men. So all the women, all the pro women went off, and then all the pro men went off. So for about half of the bike, I just was racing with women. But I knew all these men were coming eventually on the bike. And we didn't know quite how fair the start sort of differential between the men and the women were. Anyway, halfway through the bike, Chris McCormick goes by me. If any of you know Chris McCormick, he's one of the longest running, most successful triathletes in the world. He's won Ironman, and he's won world championships at the Olympic distance. He's just one of the grittiest, most audacious triathletes from Australia I've ever met. Anyway, Chris McCormick goes flying by me on the bike. And there's something wrong about the way he's going by me on the bike. And I realize that he doesn't have a seat. He's riding his triathlon bike, and he's standing on his pedals because he doesn't have a seat. His seat had broken off right after the start of the race. And I'm watching this guy, and you know, we all stand to get uphill, so you get to get a bit more power up the hill. So you stand when you want to sprint to get by somebody in triathlon, but you don't stand and ride for an hour. And Chris McCormick did that day. He rode the whole thing standing. And I later learned that he actually dropped out of the race because he started the run, but his legs were so cramped up from from standing in a big gear for an hour trying to do this race that he just couldn't run. His quads gave out. But you know, it's another one of those stories where you just like somebody is so determined not just to win, but to race. Like that's what he showed up for, and that's what I showed up in Chicago for. I really just wanted to race. And so, you know, that those kind of events just gave me perspective for the rest of my career. I mean, so much can go wrong. You can still finish. And, you know, for me, that just finding success in that way made me really proud of myself, and it ingrained this kind of key attitude, which then transported over to the next race and the next race and the next race. And so it was all this, it was always just attitude building on attitude building on attitude, which created the success for me. And you know, I learned about resilience as well, about just, you know, just doing it in the face of things going wrong, and trust, of course, trust that things will work out, trust in Lance, my coach, trust in just saying, him just saying, I'm going to do this for you, and then, you know, having my bike there in transition. It was quite amazing, you know, like, no wonder I married him, hey? So, anyway, you know, when you have races like this, and I'm sure all of you can think of times, even training sessions, when you have those kind of moments in your sport, in your training sessions, in your life, you know, it builds your attitude for sport. I see it in kids all the time. You know, it's, and we all talk about winning isn't everything, and it's not. If you watch kids play soccer, if you watch kids running cross country, you know it's not about the winning, because it's about the attitude. It's about watching kids. It's about, sometimes I'm on the hill at these cross country races, and these 10-year-olds are running, and I just give them a couple of cues, and they look at me and they smile. I mean, what does that mean? All they're doing is out there being athletic. Somebody gives them support and then they smile. That just reinforces that sport is just a whole lot of fun from a really early age. I was really lucky. I had a lot of those people in my life as I grew up. So, you know, you get a flat tire, you lose your wallet, you fall down. They're just all random occurrences in sport, and you find your way over those hurdles, and then you feel really proud of yourself. And so that leads me to believe, and it has led me to believe, that success is really not a random occurrence. Success is actually a creation, and success is something that can catch us by surprise. It rarely happens to the people who are unprepared. But one thing I read recently is about the word hope. And throughout my whole career, you know, when you're about to start a race, you have this discussion with your coach about, you know, how you're going to approach the race. What are your goals going to be for that day? And the one thing that you learn to never say is, I hope I win. Because somebody's going to say, there's no hope. You can't rely on hope. You have to actually go do something. You have to form some action to win. Well, I've recently been reading about hope. And some psychologists don't put hope in the category of a fuzzy, vague, good-feeling emotions. As in, I hope something good is going to happen to me. Hope is actually can be broken down as a combination of resiliency and goal-setting and self-belief. And I never really thought about hope that way. But the reason you can have hope and hope that you're going to win or hope you're going to have success is because you actually have planned for it. Because you actually have the belief that you are going to get to your goals, or you're going to get as far to your goals as you can on that one day. And when I read that about hope, it was very recently too. And when I was reading a sports psychology manual or sports psychology book, it really changed sort of the way I thought about that. Because we always said, you know, luck only favors the prepared. Don't rely on hope. But I don't know, I have a bit of a different perception of hope now, especially if I trace it back to all these events. I'll tell you another story. This is 1989, even earlier. I'm only 22. And I was invited to run in a road relay race in Barcelona. They were actually setting the Olympic marathon course for 1992. And they were running these road ekidins, these marathon long relay races of 6 to 8 women, and they were testing out the marathon course and looking at traffic logistics and how it was all going to pan out. And I was invited to one of these races, and I was thrilled. This was a national team event. It was a national team thing for me, and it was an international event. I got to run a 5K, which at the time was my specialty. And even more exciting is that we were going to race on New Year's Eve day. We were racing on January 31st, and that night they were going to hold a party for us. I mean, it was pretty exciting stuff in the early days of my career. And I can't really remember the trip. I had to take it from Halifax. I was still living there at the time. I used to love traveling. I used to love getting on a plane. I didn't mind the 10 hours. I loved the airports. You know, things have changed a little, but I don't find traveling quite so fun anymore with all the security. But back then, I loved it. It was a big adventure just to even have an airplane meal and all the little bits and pieces. I'm serious. I love those little meals. Anyway, we got to Barcelona, and it was amazing. Barcelona in December, it was sunny. It was 14 degrees. I remember going for a run with Lisa Harvey. We had our shorts on. It was, you know, after jumping snowbanks in Halifax for a month and the whole Christmas thing, it was really nice. It was Christmas holiday there. It was still just a really, really nice time. And I was really, really happy to be there in Barcelona. I was very excited about racing. And the day before the event, or it might have been 2 days, I can't remember all the details anymore, I went walking with Lisa Harvey. We were kind of bored of having to sit in the hotel room and put our feet up and be smart athletes. And so we went for a walk. And we chose one of the biggest streets in Barcelona to walk down. And as we're walking down, we could see this unbelievable church. We could see this incredible building sticking up above everything else. It was something like out of a fairy tale. It had these towers that were like twisted and turned, and they had flowers. It was like a castle. And you had to go closer. You had to see it. And when it was, as some people might know, it was this famous Basilica, La Sagrada Familia. It's got actually a way longer name than that in Spanish, and I can't say it. it was built, and it was designed by a man named Antonio Gaudí, who has designed so much incredible architecture in Barcelona, and I'd never heard of it, and I'd never seen it with my own eyes. And to actually see this building up close was unbelievable. It was the most amazing architectural structure I had ever seen. And Lisa and I looked at each other, and we got closer, and we got closer, and we got closer, and we looked up, and soon enough we were paying our pesos for a ticket, and we went inside, because you could go inside it, and you could go, and one of the towers was open. They now have, I think, almost all 9 or 12 towers built, but at the time only about 3 of the spires were built. And so Lisa and I started walking up one of the towers. You know, we're basically doing a hill climb the day before our race. But it was so alluring, you could not do it. And we started climbing up one of the spires of La Sagrada Familia, and you get higher and higher, and there's no glass windows or anything. It's just little slits in the rock, you know, like an old medieval castle, and you kind of look out just straight out into the open air, but you're hundreds of meters above the ground. And in fact, as you keep on climbing, and Lisa and I found this amazing, that the actual walls of the spire are curving in, so you're climbing kind of like this, you know, you're actually having to move your head down, like if you've ever climbed up St. Peter's in Rome, it's the same thing, you're kind of climbing around, and you've never been in a staircase like that. And we got to the top, and it was just fantastic. It was one of the most incredible things I've ever seen, and as you can tell, I'm still thinking about it. 22 years later, I'm still thinking about this climb.